friends, how are you doing today? I hope that wherever this video finds you, you are safe and healthy. Your family is safe and healthy, and everybody's finding creative ways to get through this bizarre situation we find ourselves in. Today, we're going to start reading Chad Daybell's blog. Now, he started this blog in the fall of 2015, right after they had settled in Rexburg, Idaho. He made 18 blog posts that were telling stories about, you know, things that have happened to him throughout his life. After the 18th blog post, he basically just went into using his blog as an advertisement. He would use it to promote his own books and also the books that he has published for various authors. Now we are going to be introduced to some of those authors, some of the names we already know. We are going to quickly learn that all the way back in the 80s, 35 years ago, he was already having visions and claiming to have all of these, you know, gifts that we continue to hear about to this day. He's had this belief system pretty much his entire adult life, starting in his late teens. So, before we get started, welcome back to my channel. If you are new here, it is great to meet you. Thank you so much for being here. I definitely invite you to subscribe and follow this Lori Vallow, Chad Daybell saga along with us. I am very proud of the community that's being built here, and I would love for you to be part of it. So as I said, there are 18 blog posts that we're going to go over, and no, we're not doing them all in one video because they are very lengthy. So what we're going to do is three per video. There'll be six different videos in this series about his blog. Now this is video number one, so you guys can expect five more after this. I'm going to record multiple a day. So just be forewarned, I'll be in the same shirt for a few and have quarantine hair for a few. Quarantine hair, don't care. It is what it is. But I'm not wearing the same clothes over and over. I'm just trying to get as much done in one day as I possibly can. So with all that out of the way, let's go ahead and dive into the first three blog posts from Chad Daybell. Chad Daybell's blog is called Standing in Holy Places. This Standing in Holy Places series is the series that was the catalyst for Lori Vallow becoming infatuated with Chad Daybell way back when the Vallow family lived in Hawaii. The about page of Chad's website reads as follows. Chad Daybell has worked in the publishing business for the past two decades and has written more than 25 books. The Times of Turmoil series is a sequel to Chad's best-selling Standing in Holy Places series, which continues to find success in both LDS bookstores and national retail chains. Chad is also known for his other novels, such as Chasing Paradise and the Emma Trilogy, as well as his nonfiction books for youth, including The Aaronic Priesthood and The Youth of Zion. He and his wife, Tammy, also created the Tiny Talk series for primary age children. He is currently the president of Spring Creek Book Company, and then it goes on to list the website. Now, you guys need to understand, that website has since been taken down. You cannot access anything about their publishing company. As always, I will have the link down below to Chad Daybell's website. Be forewarned, it is very hard to navigate, but you can definitely get in there and find all sorts of stuff. So old Chad posted his first blog post on August 10th of 2015, and he titled it, How It All Began. Welcome to my Standing in Holy Places blog. I have many experiences to share that will hopefully inform you and entertain you. I served a very memorable Spanish-speaking mission in northern New Jersey, worked as a cemetery sexton for more than a decade, served as a newspaper reporter and editor, wrote several books, and currently serve as the president of Spring Creek Book Company. I will eventually cover each of those aspects of my life, but I want to begin with an experience that happened 30 years ago this week. This event put me on the path to work with wonderful authors such as Suzanne Freeman, Julie Rowe, and Hector Sosa, who have shared their near-death experiences and visions of the future. I've been privileged to see the same future events they have, and I have incorporated them into my novels. It is time for me to explain how my journey began. In August 1985, I was 17 and heading into my senior year in Springville, Utah. Life was pretty carefree. My friends and I focused most of our time on playing and watching sports, mainly baseball and basketball. I was on the Springville JV baseball team, and I expected to play on the varsity team my senior season. I was also a church basketball star, if there is such a thing. Our ward young men's group planned a final outing before school started. We decided to camp at Flaming Gorge Reservoir in northern Utah. We had a bunch of daredevils in the group, and I suppose I was one of them. Whenever we went camping, we would select a location with high cliffs so we could jump off of them into the river or lake. Flaming Gorge had many cliffs to choose from, and we were excited. On this particular day, we started with cliffs that were about 20 feet high. That was fun, but there was a nearby cliff jutting out over the water that was about 60 feet above the surface. It looked like the perfect spot. My friends and I watched someone else jump from that ledge, and soon we were scrambling up the hillside. Once we got up there and saw how high it truly was, we were intimidated, but we were also stupid teenagers. My pals finally convinced me to go first. I leaped from the cliff, and as I descended into the water, I remember thinking, this is taking a really long time. Then I hit the water, and it felt like I slammed into concrete. A shock went through me, and I saw a white flash of light. I felt an audible pop in the back of my head, and I thought, oh no, I broke my neck. I also wondered if I had cut my forehead open because there was a brief searing pain above my eyes. Then I realized something worse was happening. My spirit was partly out of my body. The best way to describe it is my physical body went deeper into the water than my spirit did. It was as if my spirit popped out through my head, but then my spirit knees got stuck and I didn't make it all the way out. For those few moments, I looked around and saw an endless white plain in all directions. Then as my body started to return to the surface, my spirit got sucked back into place. I must have taken a long time getting to the surface because one of my friends had actually jumped in the water to rescue me. He grabbed me and we swam to the shore. All I said was, something snapped when I hit the water. I'm done for the day. After that experience, I was a changed person. I didn't care about being an athlete anymore. I decided to give up baseball. I still play basketball, but not with much enthusiasm. I don't remember talking to anyone in the white light, but I began to devour church-related books, the scriptures, amongst other authors. I had the strong impression I would need this information later in life. I still had a social life and a great set of friends, but I became very receptive to sensing spirits as well as feeling promptings and impressions. This helped me steer clear of people and situations that might have led me into trouble. In retrospect, I believe that when I hit the water, my personal veil was torn open and didn't seal back up properly. From that point on, I would occasionally get glimpses about my future. It was annoying but tolerable. Then 8 years later, I had another water-related experience that really threw the barn doors open, so to speak, on my interaction with the other side. I'll share that experience in my next entry. So Chad's veil was torn 35 years ago. His belief system now has actually been brewing since 1985. All these things that we've come to know as their gifts, as they call them these days, he was claiming to experience that back in 1985. But as he said, 8 years later, he had another water-related experience. This was posted on August 12th of 2015, and he titled it, Stay Out of the Water. Today, I will share the second water-related experience that led me to becoming an author and publish books by people who have had near-death experiences. In 1993, my wife Tammy and I went on a family vacation to San Diego, California, with my parents and siblings. We always visited La Jolla Cove during our vacation, and on this particular day, we put on our swimsuits and got ready to go. Our oldest son, Garth, was just a year old, and it was an overcast and a bit windy, so Tammy decided to stay and swim in the hotel pool with him. So I traveled with my parents and siblings to the cove. We found some shells on the beach, but there was a neat rock formation nearby that had been exposed by the low tide. My brother Brad and I climbed out on the rocks quite a ways. They seemed to get more jagged and sharp the further we went out into the water. The waves started to come in more forcefully. Brad decided to go back to the beach while I stayed on the rocks looking for shells. Suddenly I looked up and there was a monstrous wave bearing down on me. My dad was watching me from the beach and he estimated it was at least 15 feet high. I was in a precarious position on the tip of the rock. For a split second, I considered trying to ride the wave in, but I would have surely been sliced apart by the jagged rocks. An audible voice shouted in my ear, "Get down and cling to that rock." I did as the voice commanded and grabbed hold of a 2-foot-wide boulder just as the wave crashed down on me. The force was incredible, and it took all of my strength to not get ripped away and tossed around. Then my surroundings changed, and I found myself in the proverbial tunnel of light. It wasn't a bright white light, more like a warm yellow heat lamp. It felt like I was wrapped in a warm blanket or cocoon, and I felt extremely happy. This time I saw two male figures standing about 10 foot above me, and they told me several things that I still don't remember. I believe one of them was my grandpa Keith Daybell, my dad's father, who was killed in a logging accident in 1951. I will talk more about my other interactions with him in a later post. Then I returned to my body. The wave had passed and my dad and brothers were rushing towards me. Dad said, "I was sure you were dead." I guess he was half right. We looked at my hands and my fingertips were all shredded from where I had clung onto the rock. I must have let go when my spirit left my body, though, because I had been tossed around and the left side of my back had large gashes. We loaded me up and took me to the hospital to get stitches. Thankfully, I did not receive any long-lasting injuries. There was a long-term effect from the incident, though. My personal veil had been ripped open again, and this time it didn't close nearly as much as it had after my Flaming Gorge experience. I started having deja vu experiences and other waking visions where I could see the outcomes of certain choices of my family. I also had direct intervention in my life from the other side. I had graduated from BYU with a bachelor's degree and was working at the Ogden Standard Examiner at the time. My dad was strongly encouraging me to start working on a master's degree through Utah State. It made sense if I wanted to move up in the publishing world. I went to the Utah State University Extension office in downtown Ogden and picked up an application. But as I sat down at a table to fill it out, it felt like the pen I was holding was on fire. I dropped it and distinctly heard the words, "This is the wrong direction for you. You won't need additional schooling to accomplish your life's mission." This voice was accompanied by one of the strongest burning of the bosom moments I've ever had. I stood up and threw the application in a recycling bin. This answer really was a shock to me because my long-term goal growing up had been to eventually earn a doctorate degree. The interesting thing is that although I was by far the most studious of my brothers, they all now have advanced degrees and I don't. But the voice was correct. If I had returned to college, none of what has happened since could have taken place. I never would have become an author or been in a position to help these other authors and publish their experiences. So in 1993, that veil was torn wide open. He saw his grandpa. All of a sudden, he was getting more information from the other side. They were leading him down the path of what his life's mission is going to be. So we're looking at 27 years since that experience. Now, were those experiences laying the groundwork for where we are today? In my opinion, absolutely. Because very early on in his life, he believed he had these gifts, the ability to communicate from the other side and make the other side responsible for what is going on in his life. I'm not sure how great those choices have turned out for him in the last 2 years, but that's not for me to decide at this point. His third blog post is titled "A Voice in the Cemetery." In my previous post, I mentioned I was working in the early 1990s at the Ogden Standard Examiner. It was a full-scale operation with a bustling newsroom and dozens of employees, and I was right on the front lines in producing the paper each day. I had been the city editor for BYU's Daily Universe, but this was a major step up. I was hired as a copy editor, and I am grateful for the newspaper copy chief, Peg Barney, took a chance on the rookie from BYU. I truly bonded with some of the best and brightest coworkers I've ever had. On the copy desk, we had non-Mormons, ex-Mormons, lapsed Mormons, and a couple of active Mormons, and we all got along well. This was an exciting time when the typesetting programs were being implemented. But when I first started there, we still actually cut and pasted the newspaper together. On the copy desk, we would design the pages, edit the stories, write the headlines, then send the articles to the back room. If the article ended up being longer than we planned, I would go to the back room and decide which part of the story to cut out. Then with a knife, we would literally cut the text and paste it onto the page board. Then I would look at the entire page over and sign off on it. If there was an error, it was my fault. So there was a lot of stress as the daily deadline approached, with people running everywhere and shouting to each other as we all tried to do three things at once. I would be writing a headline, but listening to someone shout, "Chad, get back here and cut this story." Or, "The headline isn't long enough, rewrite it." The job was invigorating, and although I wasn't earning a master's degree as I had once planned, I was experiencing a hands-on crash course in writing, editing, and publishing. That's why my books feel like an all-knowing reporter is describing the action. I know some people would like me to write flowing poetic verse with lots of adjectives and adverbs, but that's just not my style. I was trained as an editor to chop out the excess and get right to the point. Randy Hollis was a sports editor, and he had written and published a book. I was impressed. Tammy and I would go to the Weber County Library, and I imagined what it would be like to see my name on the spine of a book there. But the editing job kind of fried my brain each day. After 8 hours on the computer at work, the last thing I wanted to do was go home and type. Besides, I had no idea what to write about, so I put it on the back burner. The 8-hour shifts went quickly because you really didn't have a break. On Friday and Saturday nights, it was usually just one other copy editor and myself designing every page and writing every headline in the newspaper. Since I had an interest in sports, I became the main copy editor for the sports section, and I really enjoyed that. Friday nights during football season were always a mad scramble as the high school football stories came rolling in all at once. Then we'd get to do it all again the next night with college football games. Somehow, by 12:15 a.m., we had it all put together and sent to the press. Despite the excitement of the job, it was physically wearing me down. At that time, the Standard Examiner was an afternoon paper with morning deliveries on Saturday and Sunday. So I would work on Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday from 4:30 a.m. to 1 p.m., then reverse the clock on Friday and Saturday and work from 4 p.m. to 12:30 a.m. I got Sundays and Mondays off. The schedule was really nice in terms of being with Tammy and our young children for most of the day, but I rarely got a good night's sleep because of getting up so early and then switching the schedule on the weekends. Plus, I was getting paid what copy editors usually got. Not a whole lot. Tammy and I both felt a yearning to have our children grow up near their grandparents, and we felt that a change was coming in our lives. One night, my brother called me and said Springville Cemetery sexton was going to retire. I had worked part-time in Springville Cemetery while I attended BYU, and I felt that it was the right time to make a move. I applied for the position and was hired. So I went from writing headlines to digging graves. It was a strange transition, but it paid better and allowed us to move back to Springville. In late 1997, the cemetery got hit by a big snowstorm. We had a funeral coming later that day, so I was shoveling a path across the grass to the gravesite. From out of nowhere came a voice that said, "It's time to write your books." This came as a complete surprise to me. I had written some family histories, but I'd never been able to come up with a plot for a book. I leaned on the shovel and said aloud, "That's great, but I have no idea what to write about." Almost immediately, the entire plot of my first novel, An Errand for Emma, came to me. I wrote the book within a few months, and it was accepted for publication by Cedar Fort Publishing. The novel became a regional bestseller. I got a lot of publicity about the gravedigger who wrote a novel. We traveled as a family around the West doing book signings, and it was a fun time. My publisher wanted me to write a follow-up book, but I couldn't come up with a good idea. So I did the logical thing and prayed about it while I was working in the cemetery. I didn't hear a voice this time, but the plot to Doug's Dilemma filled my head, as well as the plot for Escape to Zion. These three books became known as the Emma Trilogy, a time travel series that actually sets the stage for my Standing in Holy Places series. In my next post, I will share how I came to meet Suzanne Freeman and publish her books about her near-death experience. Now, these three blog posts cover dates from 1985 through 1997. We are going to find as we move throughout all of his posts that his timeline does jump around quite a bit. But in this 12-year time frame, we can see from when he had his first, what he calls, near-death experience in 1985 up until 1997, he was really starting to put more and more stock into the direction that he was receiving through his torn veil. Now, in future blog posts, he does jump around all over the place, but he does list dates pretty well, so you can kind of, you know, fit them into the timeline. Wherever this video finds you, I hope you guys are having the best day ever. Again, I hope you are safe and healthy. I hope your family is the same way. I'm sending good vibes to everybody because what we are dealing with right now is absolutely insane, and we need to lean on each other in any way we can. You guys, make it a great day. Make good choices, and we will talk very soon. Bye, guys.